Hi! In the second part of this video series, we will describe the anatomy of each mucosal fold of the middle ear one by one. Then, we will use this information in order to define complex structures such as the tympanic diaphragm and the tympanic isthmus, or isthmuses. It's not always easy to give straightforward definitions as controversies exist between researchers. I hope that these visualizations will make your struggle through massive 2D textbooks an easier journey. So, let's start! As a brief recap from the previous video, let's remember the fixed structures of the middle ear. These are essential for proceeding. Under the 5+2 umbrella, we grouped the malleus attaching ligaments. Try to recall the anterior, lateral, and superior suspensori, the anterior and posterior mallear, and the pair of the anterior and posterior tympanomallear ligaments. Incus had two ligaments, the superior and the posterior. As for sapis, we only talked about the annular one. Three extra structures were being described in the end: the tensor tendon, the tendon of the stapedial muscle, and chorda tympani. These 10 ligaments and 3 extra structures are more than enough for setting the scaffold of the middle ear cleft. As a guide, we will refer to the mucosal folds in an anterior-posterior direction, starting from those closer to the protympanum. The tensor fold has a quadrangular conformation. Anteriorly, it is attached to the supratubal ridge of the protympanum, over the Eustachian tube orifice. Medially, to the wall of the tensor canaliculus. Laterally, to the anterior process and ligament of the malleus, and posteriorly to the tensor tendon as a free edge. The anterior mallear fold is not a flat surface. Imagine it as a bent triangular flap extending between the trunks of the tympanic ring's anterior bifurcation. This fan-like structure emerges from the anterior tympanic spine, spreads posteriorly and attaches to the neck and lateral process of the malleus. Superiorly, it contains connective tissue bundles of the anterior suspensory ligament of the malleus. At that level, the fold reflects posteriorly, fusing with the lateral mallear fold. This is the border where the anterior mallear fold starts participating at the formation of Prusak space roof, as we'll see later on. Moving inferiorly, the fold turns laterally, following the curvature of the lateral mallear process. At the level of greatest concavity, the anterior mallear fold meets the anterior process and ligament of the malleus, fusing medially with the tensor fold. Then, it reflects laterally, attaching to the anterior tympanomallear ligament in a horizontal plane. The lateral mallear fold has the form of a trapezium, filling the gap between the mallear neck and the scutal rim. It is divided to an anterior strong and a posterior weak portion. Anteriorly, the lateral mallear fold encloses the lateral mallear ligament, while fusing with the anterior mallear fold. Its posterior limit is the posterior mallear ligament. The posterior mallear fold has been described as a duplication of the tympanic membrane in the past, and false conclusions were made about its existence by leading otologists at the time. The triangle between the posterior mallear ligament, the medial rim of the posterior tympanic spine, and chorda tympani mark the circumference of this fold. The inferior edge can also lie freely in middle ear space. Then, chorda tympani has its own mesentery, as a narrow mucosal strip connecting the nerve with the posterior mallear ligament or fold. This strip, when existing, is called chordal fold. The superior mallear and incudal folds were described by Bruce Proctor as a coronal and as a sagittal fold containing the superior mallear and incudal ligaments respectively. These structures are usually used to divide the attic into an anterior, a posteromedial, and a posterolateral compartment. Mucosal deficits, such as the incisura tentoris of the superior mallear fold, were also described in order to allow the passage of the aeration pathways. Tauno Palva, after 125 middle ear microdissections, referred to these largely reproduced folds as pure fantasy in normal ears. he suggested that the most constant structure fastening the oscillus to the tegment is the superior malleolar ligament. Every extra element in the area was attributed to inflammatory webs. The lateral incudomallear fold lies between the posterior incudal ligament, the short process of incus, and the lateral attic wall. The anteriormost portion of this fold is subject to multiple variations that alter the aeration routes of the area. The implications of mucosal fold variant anatomy on the middle ear ventilation will be addressed in the future after having established an understanding of the basic anatomy. In this model, the fold has an anterior downslope, inserting to the posterior malleolar ligament. If we take a closer look into the anatomy of the posterior incudal ligament, we'll see that it is a bifid structure with a 90-degree angle between a stronger lateral and a weaker medial trunk. The posterior incudal ligamental fold lies between the two connective tissue bundles of the posterior incudal ligament. The medial incudal fold is also an area of debate. It was initially described as a duplicate fold forming from the passage of the expanding air sacs over the two sides of the incus log process. Bruce Proctor stresses the importance of this fold while describing the posterior tympanic isthmus. So, after having described the anatomy of almost every middle ear fold, we are ready to get into the notion of the tympanic isthmus or isthmuses and the tympanic diaphragm. The tympanic diaphragm is the set of ossicles and membranes that separate the epitympanum from the mesotympanum. From a superior view, the diaphragm is comprised by the tensor fold, the anterior malleolar fold, the lateral incudomallear, and the posterior incudal fold. The heads of malleus and incus make up the center of this formation. The tympanic isthmus is the main unobstructed pathway traversing the tympanic diaphragm. We can think about two air columns, one between the nasopharynx and the mesotympanum, and another one between the attic and the mastoid air cells. The narrowest passage connecting these two columns is the tympanic isthmus. Bruce Proctor divided this structure in two parts. The empty space between the tensor tendon and the icudostapedial articulation was described as the anterior tympanic isthmus. The space between the icudostapedial joint and the retrotympanum was in the major part occluded by the medial incudal fold, leaving only a narrow slit posteriorly acting as a posterior tympanic isthmus. In contrast, Taunopalva insisted that the medial incudal fold regresses early after its embryologic formation, and that it doesn't exist in normal ears. He defined the tympanic isthmus as a single entity, extending from the retrotympanum to the tensor fold and from the incudal body to the medial wall of the middle ear. He gave the term posterior tympanic isthmus or auxiliary aeration route to a deficit of the posterior incudal fold that happens in 1 to 4 normal ears. But again, this pathway has not a major role in the aeration of the epitympanum. The second definition is less mentioned but probably represents more the reality. That's all for part 2. In the next video, we will use the structures we have just described in order to divide the epitympanum and upper mesotympanum in interconnecting spaces. This last step will make us understand the multiple ventilation pathways of the middle ear. Now, take some time and try to build the same model in your mind. When you manage to build that mental 3D image, everything will look much simpler. Bye, see you in the next part.